Transforming People, Transforming Cities 2013. Manor Mission Church invites you to The Gospel Transforms Life, featuring host Reverend Ebenezer Ablor, Reverend Drs. Izan Samar Kwa, and Seth M. Ablor, with praise and worship from Tim Karikari Boateng. August 29th to Saturday, August 31st, at Barking Methodist Church, 39 London Road, Barking, Essex, daily from 6:30 p.m. Call 020 8517 1980 and be transformed.
Just lift your voice, just lift your voice. In the name of your holy child, Jesus, we receive this word because it's ours. You're in us and we're in you. You, we live and we move and we have our being. We thank you for this word and we receive it from the crown of our heads to the soles of our feet. It's in us to do something with it. Not to keep it, but to do something with it. Lord, you reminded me this afternoon that this conference, the reason we are gathered together to minister one to another, is not to take it out and sit in the parking lot. Because this is not a parking lot, it's a filling station. We're to be filled and take it to the highways and the byways of life. To needy people, suffering, dying, sighing, crying humanity. And we receive this word. We're not only blessed, but we're going to become a blessing to others because we've received it. We thank you for it in Jesus.
There is someone waiting at the door of your heart. Ask him in. Ask him in. It's not too late for a new life to start. Ask him in. Ask him in. Jesus is the healer of a life that's broken, a heart that's hurting, shattered dreams gone away. And now, while he's calling, whispering your name, ask him in.
You've enjoyed these songs. I've sure enjoyed singing them. I prepared these songs especially to help meet a need in your life. A need spiritually, physically, financially, emotionally, and in your family. To help you get in a position to believe that God can work a miracle for you. Someone once said that a song is a sermon that can never be preached. It prepares you to hear the word of God and to receive the prayer of faith. In just a moment, I'm going to pray for you. When I do, I want you to believe God for a miracle. You see, I want to give you an opportunity to get your heart right with God. So get yourself ready. In just a moment, I'll be ready to open my heart and pray the prayer of faith, the prayer of faith that shall save the sick and raise you up. Jesus is the healer of a life that's broken, a heart that
hiding, shattered dreams gone.
Now I'm ready to pray for you. Why don't you take a moment and stop what you're doing? If you're alone, touch yourself as we pray. Or if you're with someone, just join hands with them and let me pray a prayer for you. Heavenly Father, I come to you not in my name nor my strength, but in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, my Lord and Savior. I thank you, Lord, that you're a good God, a healing God, a God of miracles, salvation. Thank you, Lord, for it in Jesus' name. Now, friend, I pray for you. I speak to the problem in your life. I speak to the fear. I speak to the torment. I speak to the problem. I speak to the sickness, to the disease, to the thing that's unlike God in your life. And I command it in the name of Jesus to come out and for you to be healed from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet in Jesus' mighty name. And I pray for you to be closer to God than you've ever been, for you to know, I mean really know, that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. For you to believe that it is in Him that you live and move and have your being. I pray this in faith. I pray it believing, expecting a miracle in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. I felt that prayer and I expect God to begin moving in your behalf. Thank God for it. And now as I close, let me leave you with these powerful words. No matter what it looks like, no matter what the devil has thrown at you, no matter what circumstances say, remember this. God, my Heavenly Father, can take the situation and He can turn it around for you.
No! Thank you, musicians. They've done very well. Hallelujah. They've been standing for about 1 hour now. Hallelujah. Beloved, I stand before you in the name that is above every name. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Hallelujah. In 2009, we had a wonderful conference in Ghana. Then I had a privilege to join a group of pastors in Côte d'Ivoire, Abidjan, with Dr. Cirulo. And while the service was going on, the Lord said something to me. He said that Europe is sinking. Europe is sinking and sinking fast. And I need people to represent me on that continent. And the Lord beckoned my heart. Said, I want you to go back to UK and begin transforming cities. That the life of the ordinary Christian will be transformed and have better understanding of the work of God. I didn't disobey the voice. I responded. And Lord sovereignly had moved. Through this program, you will have the privilege to listen to preachers that you wouldn't have listened to. The last two conferences have been very successful. Last year, we had a sister who had cancer. And she's a Christian, all right. But last year, she entered the same building less than 10 minutes. Her situation was said by a woman of God. A prayer was made for her. And a month later, the doctors took care of the treatment. No cancer cell anymore. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a big clap. Now, tomorrow I will show you another testimony. But at least, I know a young man over here. I will leave this testimony for him to share as well. What God can do for your finances. Now, the essence of this meeting is to transform you and change the way you think about Christianity and how you walk your Christian life. So this is how Transforming People, Transforming City was born. And we have had 3 preachers already. Larry Robert has come here. You are listening to veterans of the faith. You are privileged. You are privileged. You may have heard many preachers who won the gathering of the champions. But this program will offer you a chance of listening to preachers who have gone the miles, have seen the miracles, they've seen the healing. So when they speak, you better have to listen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I am privileged. 1990, I sat under the ministry of this man of God. I still have some of the preachings he preached till today. And they inspire me. It's one of the things that opened my eyes to Christianity. And there is no better topic than the topic we are looking at. That was the topic he was preaching on in 1990. The power of the gospel in action. I am honored this evening to introduce to you our guest speaker, Reverend Izan Somiawa. Let's give the Lord a big clap. Let's give the Lord. Let's stand on our feet and welcome the man of God. Let's stand on our feet and welcome the man of God. The man of God, I'm honored to introduce to you the people. You may be seated.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
When
when you get happy, these few days we're going to spend together. Say amen.
Amen.
The last time I checked my Bible, it told me that Elisha's Holy Ghost gets happy when the praise and worship leader sings songs and plays on his guitar. I love music. I get happy, but there is something else that let my Holy Ghost get happy. And I need you to get me happy. If you don't get me happy, I cannot release it to you. Are you ready to say, to do that which makes my Holy Ghost get happy?
Yes.
Are you ready for it?
Yes.
Are you someone who wants to get happy? Because when I get happy, I'm a wild man. Very wild. But when you say amen, my Holy Ghost gets happy.
Washington.
Virginia area doing, you know, a revival. And then I told the people, when you get happy, you know, all I want you to do, don't say it, and say, ooh. So when they got happy, I'm happy, I'm going, and I hear the congregation, ooh, yes, God. Get happy. How many of you love Jesus? My goodness. We have prayed for you.
Amen.
And I believe God. I don't play church. If you want to play church, I'm not your preacher. You hear me? Because when you understand the price that Jesus Christ paid so that you and I can be saved, you don't play with that. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
You don't play with that. You don't play with this. It wasn't an angel who came down here to die. It was God. It was Emmanuel. God in the flesh. God became man to pay the price for you and for me so that we can be delivered. So we don't play with this message. I promise you, we only have about 4 days or 3 days. I'm going to try to put something in your heart.
Amen.
I'm going to try to give you something.
Amen.
You hear me?
Yes.
For 35 years, I've followed this God. No backsliding. No foolishness. He's my life. He's my life. I live by faith. God never allowed me to work with my PhD for 35 years. I took this book. This is my life. You play with it. I don't play with it. Are you hearing me? This is my life. And this is supposed to be your life. You hear me now? I have walked with this God closely. I don't care about ministry. Hear me carefully. Are there pastors here? Are there ministers in our midst? Are there those who are called of God to follow him and serve him? Come on, let me. Are there people here who say, Pastor, I've got a call of God in my heart. I want to serve God someday. Come on, let me see your hand. Anybody here like that? Anybody who want to serve God? Come on, why don't you want to serve God? Why don't you love this God? If you love him, you serve him. Come on, if you love God, the logical thing is to serve him. Come on. Are you here? Oh, you are not happy. I know you ain't happy. I know you ain't happy. My goodness. Listen, don't try to figure me out because you can never figure me out. You hear me now? You cannot figure a preacher out who lives by the Holy Ghost. Never. You hear me now? So you can't figure me out. Then follow me. Let's go. Let's go by the Spirit of God. Right? He's going to lead us. Don't you believe the Holy Ghost leads?
Yeah.
You don't believe that? My goodness. And I'm a very weird man. I have no no style of preaching. He says, oh, don't forget me, I'll mess you up completely. But I love you. I'm a man of love. I've been blessed by God to know His love. Are you hearing that?
Yes, sir.
Somebody's going to get blessed tonight.
Yeah.
Woo! Boy. Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. For 35 years, I've never seen a doctor. You didn't say amen.
Yeah.
I look younger than most of you. And yet I'm almost 64. You hear me? Are you hearing me? I'm talking about the power of God to keep a soul. I'm not talking about the power of church. Talk about the power of the living God to keep you healthy. Boy, it sounds weird to you, right? Sound weird. Ain't weird. That's Bible. That's gospel. Peter said we should be kept by the power of God. See that? You can't figure it out. Don't worry. Just receive what the Holy Ghost is going to give to you. Right? Don't use your mind. Use your heart.
Amen.
Let it go here. Because I'm going to talk to your heart. I'm going to bypass your mind and get hold of your heart. You hear me? When I get hold of this guy, this man here will bow.
Amen.
Yeah. So when I say I love you, I'm not joking with your life. It's serious business. The gospel is serious. It's the only message that transforms life. That transforms nations.
Amen.
The only message. And we are supposed to have the only message that saves and transforms and makes a wicked man righteous, a prostitute holy woman. Do you believe this message? Do you believe the gospel of Jesus Christ? How many of you are going to heaven? You sure you go to heaven?
Yes.
Are you living the life that takes you to heaven?
Yes.
I get about 3 years. My goodness. I want to get your attention very well on just a passage of scripture that we all know very well. If I asked you, you could quote it verbatim, word for word. And I'm going to ask you, how many of you know the verse in scripture called John 3:16? Huh? How many know it off by heart? You can quote it. Somebody quote it for me. John 3:16. What? My goodness, you know it. Wow. You know John 3:16. But tonight, I'm going to let you know that you don't understand John 3:16. You want to know? You want to know what that one word is all about? That we quoted so flippantly. We take it for granted. Do you know what is in that word? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whosoever, remember whosoever, white man, yellow man, black man, blue man, indigo man, green man, Indian man, African man, European man, whosoever is in that word, everyone is in there, anyone, it doesn't matter, poor man, rich man, whosoever believeth on him. Now, who was talking that? Who brought that word out? Oh, it was Jesus. It was Jesus talking. It was Jesus, not talk to me, talk to me. I said my manner of preaching is weird. Alright? But you can't figure it out. Was it Jesus talking that word? Jesus comes down and he says, my father sent me here. And my father told me, said, Jesus, when you go down there and you present my message, you tell them of my love, you tell them of my power to save them, my love for them, my desire to bless them, to deliver them, to heal them, to make a way for them. Jesus, when you go down there and you tell them that I, the Almighty God, I care for them, I, the Almighty God, I did not leave them down in their sins, that I sent you, Jesus, to come and pay the price and deliver them. So Jesus, if anyone, who is that? Shut up. If anyone sees you, hears, and believes that I sent you to come and die for them, to come and deliver them, to come and heal them, make a way for them out of nowhere, if anybody hears and believes that I, Father God, I sent you for them, and they don't harden their hearts, they don't rebel against my word, they don't disobey, but they believe and they receive that message. Jesus, I want you to give them two guarantees. Listen to me carefully. The Father said, Jesus, if they believe you, if anyone believes you, give them two guarantees. Guarantee two things to them. First, anyone who hears my word and believes, tell them, guarantee that in the midst of their hurt, of their struggles, of their pain, of their confusion, of their frustration in life, in the midst of earth's problems, I, the Almighty God, I guarantee them that they will not perish. Amen. They will not be destroyed. You all don't understand yet. Brother, when I got hold of that message, power of eternal life. I didn't say the power of church. eternal life. Jesus' first guarantee, I don't care what the devil throws at them. I don't care what sicknesses come against them to affect them. I don't care what financial adversities may befall them. I say unto you, Jesus guaranteed to them that they cannot be destroyed.
Off.
My goodness. I'm Because I'm not a preacher. I'm not a preacher. I'm called to walk with God, to experience Him, and to make Him known.
Amen.
That is my work. I have been blessed by God to experience the love of God, the peace of God, the joy of God.
Amen.
This has been my portion for the last 35 years.
Amen.
In this realm is life. In this realm is peace. In this realm is health. Am I crazy?
No.
I'm not crazy. But I so desire to bless somebody. You know, he says that which was from the beginning, right? Which we have heard, which we have seen, and then have handled with our hands, right? You know, concerning the word of life. And the word was made manifest, right? And we have seen it. And we do bear witness of that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard, that declare we unto you, so that you also have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and His Son Jesus Christ. That's why we preach. That's why we teach, to call men into fellowship. Paul said, you all are partakers of my grace. You see, when a man of God stands before God's people, he better know what he's doing. No foolishness here. You hear that? This is the life of God's sheep. This is the sheep of God, purchased with His own blood. And you come and stand before them and lie to them, say foolishness with their souls. Ooh, great will be the damnation of that man of God who plays with the souls of men. You hear me? It's serious business. I tremble. Because I know God looks at my heart as I preach. I know God searches my heart as I stand here. I know every word I'm saying is being written down in the heavens. So I better be true. Y'all don't fear God. Do you fear God? Do you have the fear of God inside you? Why then do you love sin? Oh, I've gone there. I shouldn't have gone there. I shouldn't have said that. But I've gone there. Because the Bible says, the fear of God, I know you tell me it's the beginning of wisdom, I know that. But you know the other one? The fear of God is to what? Keep away from evil. So when you have the fear of God inside you, right? When you see evil, you ain't going there. You know it's evil. You won't touch it. And you hear me? We're talking about the power of the gospel. The power of the word of God to keep you from evil. The fear of God is to hate evil. I know you don't like my word. It don't matter. It don't matter. If you don't like it, it don't matter. I'm happy anyway. I'm happy. I'll enjoy my word, you know, and then go home and enjoy my wife too. Ain't that something? Oh, yes, I got somebody. Amen. Hey. Good for yours, man. My goodness. But listen. God gave us a guarantee that our life on earth, when we come to Jesus Christ and believe on the message of God's love for us, our life on earth, regardless of how many devils come against us, regardless of what kind of circumstance, I don't care. This life inside here, I'm going ahead of myself, but I'll bring you along. Regardless of what happens to your life, Satan can never destroy.
Amen.
That's the first guarantee. You will not perish. For God so loved the world that he gave Jesus, so that if you and I believe on him, receive him into our hearts, he said, no infernal power can ever destroy us. Believe me, you've got to have that revealed in your heart. You've got to have that word revealed in your heart, the guarantee that regardless of how things go for you, what circumstances, what tragedies come against your life, God says, because you have believed on Jesus Christ, you know you'll not be destroyed.
Amen.
That's what you're going through. Hear me? I know you quoted it beautifully, but it's more than quoting. So it is with every word of God. It is not about quoting it. It's about experience, what you quote. Many read the word of God, but are not doers of the word. Many read the word of God, but just in their head. Never come down here. But the power of the word of God must be revealed in the heart of man. In the heart is where revelation works. The heart of man is the depository of the revelations of God. The heart of man, there God reveals himself. And you are not going to be able to walk with God unless you know him from the heart. You will never stand firm. Your faith will never get hold of God unless it becomes real in the heart. Are you hearing? We've been called to walk by faith and not by sight. By faith, you know, faith is the only sight we need in the spiritual realm. So faith is sight in the spirit. Sight, this physical eye, is sight in the natural. But in the spirit, faith, we believe and we know. We believe and we encounter. We believe and we experience. The reason why I've told God to give me 120 years, how about 120 years? Boy, I've got a lot of years more in the Holy Ghost. Can you imagine, oh my brethren, one testimony that I always bear for the Lord Jesus Christ is the manifestation of his life and his joy in my soul as I'm preaching. Because I'm blessed, I'm happy. I ain't got no money, don't ask me for money. All right, don't ask me for money. I don't have it, I can't help you. They're like, then why are you preaching? Oh my goodness, I don't preach for money. I have the bank of God with me. Hallelujah. Listen. Oh, I want to create the joy of God in the word of God in somebody's heart. Because most of you don't have joy. You only have listen to me. I haven't forgotten about the two guarantees. Don't worry, let's go by the Holy Ghost. I'll come back there. See, most of you, you have joy when all your bills are paid. When you have promotion on your job. Wow, the Lord bless me. Pastor, how did he bless me? I got promotion. Well, ain't nothing wrong with that. Ain't nothing wrong with that. Wonderful. But how about the ungodly? He got promotion too. Huh? The ungodly gets promotion too. Come on. The world gets promotion. Right? So if you are a son of God and you got promotion, what do you have that the world don't have? You see that? Now come on, follow me. Because most of you, your joy and your interest in following Jesus is because of the bread and butter. The bread and butter that he gives you all the time. The paycheck and money coming to your pocket all the time. Then so that is the blessing of the Lord. You kidding me? Is that what Jesus Christ left heaven to come down here to die, pay that price so that he can pay your bills? Is that the blessing of the gospel we're talking about? Jesus died so that I can pay my bills. What are you talking about? Are you hearing me? I told you I ain't got no money in my pocket, but I have never lacked anything from God. Are you hearing me? I'm not lying to you. I'm not lying to you. There is a realm. This gospel takes us out of the natural life into a supernatural life. I'm tired of the foolishness that goes on in pulpits across this world. Listen, I travel all the time. So I know what I'm talking about. Foolishness. Yeah, I like that. The boy, Pastor Ingram, this preacher is crazy. I'm not crazy. Your joy, the joy that God gives, hear me carefully, because it is time for the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ to be unfolded. So much foolishness. Now it is made the gospel of prosperity in America. I don't know whether it's here or not. Maybe it's here too. Is it here? The gospel of prosperity. Is that what Jesus Christ died to bring to you? Now don't get me wrong. Jesus takes care of his own. You hear me? Jesus takes care of his own. And I want everybody to hear me good. Jesus Christ takes care of his home. I have been young and I am old, says David. Yet I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. Are you hearing me? Now, do you believe the word of God or not? Do you believe the word of God, or you just select which ones you want to believe? Paul says, I preach the whole counsel. Right? The whole counsel. So don't pick and choose. Preach the whole counsel of God. Listen to me. The joy that God gives does not depend on the material settings of your life. Hear me carefully. The joy that Jesus gives is independent of how rich you are or how poor you are. It don't matter. Hear me carefully. We're talking about victory. Talking about victory. And to have joy from heaven poured into your being from your daily communion with God, and yet we ain't got no dime in your pocket. Are you hearing me? To have heaven fill your being with the joy of heaven while you ain't got no dime in your pocket. I'm the weirdest preacher. I'm going to tell you the truth. Oh my goodness. Can we walk together or go our separate ways? Can we?
Yes.
We can?
Yes.
Are you sure you can walk with me?
Yes.
Oh my goodness. Listen. Joy comes from God. Human joy on earth is material related. The joy that this world gives is related to circumstances. Oh, all my bills are paid, all my family is blessed, everything is going all right. So Lord, I thank you, I'm happy. You are happy because there's nothing wrong going on. You see that? You are happy, you are joyful, because there's nothing bad going on anywhere. But can you be joyful when all hell breaks loose? Can you be joyful in the midst of hell? I'm talking about the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You see, y'all think of power in the sense of, you know, miracles. Oh, they are amazing miracles. I've seen the blind see, the lame walk, the deaf hear, the ears, everything. Open, crippled legs. I've seen that. But I'm talking about the power from heaven that can take care of your inner life. Always filled with the love of heaven, always filled with peace, regardless of your outward circumstances. Are you hearing me? I have come here in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I've come here to make it known that gospel is God's power, but it's God's power that keeps the man who believes, keeps him from being destroyed, keeps his inner life in spite of the outward circumstances. Your inner life is filled with joy, filled with peace, filled with love. And yet you ain't gonna die in your pocket. I didn't come here to bring some religious message. No. I came here to declare the word of God. You can have joy. I haven't finished with the first guarantee, then go to the second guarantee. So it seems like it's straight. No, I'm going to get all out together. Listen to me. I see many young people here. I came to Jesus Christ when I was 27 years old. I was a devil. I used to go to the Methodist church when I was back at home. And I was a devil. You didn't say amen. I was a devil. I used to. When I got born again and God, you know, delivered me, made me a minister. I became, a pastor of a Methodist church in the U.S. only lasted 1 year because my Holy Ghost was too hot. Listen, brethren, I love you. My heart is on fire with the love of God as I see what is happening to your life here, as I see what God desires to do in your life, as I hear the Spirit of God telling me to not keep silent but to declare what He has poured in my heart. God is after you. The Lord God is after you. The Lord God is not satisfied just to let you go to church. Most of you, you only go to church and you don't walk with God. It's a difference. You know who taught me? The Holy Ghost taught me 35 years ago. Son, don't just go to church. Walk with me daily. Spend time in my presence daily. Get to know the God who died for you and delivered you daily. It's a daily walk. It's not a weekly walk. It's not Sunday. It's Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. 7 days, you walk with Jesus. 7 days. Some of you, you walk with Jesus Sunday. Then Monday, the other guy comes in. You know the other guy? The other guy. You know him? The crooked-legged one. The slew foot. But they call him the devil. Then you walk with him Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday night. You go to the beer bars. I know you all don't like it. But it don't matter. I'm happy. I'm telling the truth. And then when Sunday comes, then you are Moses. You are Sarah. I don't know who you are. Nebuchadnezzar's wife. When Sunday comes, hey, Pastor Evan, hi. And you know Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, you don't walk with Jesus. And then Sunday, I love you, Jesus. Lying devil. That's what I call lying devil. Deceiving God and deceiving yourself. Come on. If the gospel is going to be gospel, if its power is going to be made manifest in our lives, we better be real with God. Where are the amens? I told you my Holy Ghost gets happy when you say amen.
Amen.
You ain't saying amen.
Amen.
I love you. You know, my joy is to be able to lift somebody up to the realm where they can have what I got in my Holy Ghost. This joy is real. This joy money can buy. This joy Holy Ghost gives. It is for free. Free. Free man, free from heaven. That's our inheritance. That's our portion, to know him who died for us. Not just to go to church. Yeah. Oh boy, I like it. The angels are saying, go. God, the Lord taught me the spirit of my gospel is love. You cannot love those that you say you know that why you cannot minister to them if you don't love them. Because it was love that brought me from heaven. You see that? Love brought me from heaven. It was my compassion that healed. Because I cared intensely. I didn't just minister to them. I cared for them. Their hearts were broken. They were like sheep without shepherd. And I could not just leave them in their misery. When I minister, I sweat the Lord. You know why I sweat? You know why? It's fire. There's fire in my being that burns. That's why I sweat. Joy, peace, a mixture of joy, peace, love. And our God is all of that, and He's a consuming fire too. Ministers, don't get mad at me when I say that, because that's my responsibility. Let me say something. In the house of God, the sheep follow the shepherd. In the house of God, the shepherd sets the tone. In the house of God, the shepherd must manifest and model before the sheep what he wants them to see and follow. Jesus said, I know my sheep, and they hear my voice, they know my voice, and they follow me. He said, when the good shepherd has taken his sheep and brought them out, he said, He goes before them and before them. He goes before them and the sheep follows. Has it dawned on you what was happening to Peter and John and James and Andrew when they were following Jesus? When he was walking and they were following him? Hey, Peter. What manner of man is that? Wow. This is something. Look at how he walks. Look at how he talks. Wow, can we also do that? Well, let's go ask him. Jesus, we've seen that anytime you go and go to that mountain, you do some strange stuff. You say you are praying. Anytime you come back from that mountain, there's some strange power. What is that, Jesus? It's called the power of prayer. Wow, can we also do that? Yeah, you can. All right, Jesus, teach us to pray. As John also taught his disciples, teach us to pray. Jesus never talked before he prayed. You see that? He prayed. And pray and walk in the power of prayer before the disciples. He caught their attention. Anybody who comes to me will catch fire. I can't hide it. You catch fire. Why? Because I don't play foolishness. I'm busy looking for God. I'm busy walking with Him. I'm busy learning how to commune, how to walk with Him, how to be obedient, how to surrender my life to Him. And you walk with me and you will not learn that. What are you talking about? You don't follow me to eat barbecues. You follow me to walk with Jesus. And yet Paul said that which you have seen, you have heard and learned and seen in saw you do and how you walk, if we follow you, do the same thing, the God of peace will be with us. I'm talking something to you straight. If your sheep cannot imitate your life, you don't belong to the pulpit. My goodness.
Possess.
What do you mean of the word possess?
To own.
Huh? Own. Make it your own. You see that? Make it your own. Be the owner of something. Make it your own. Alright? Okay. So he said, Jesus, tell them, not only will they not perish, but they will have. They will possess. There is something that I will give to them that will become part of their life. See that? And nobody can take that away from them. They will possess something. Listen, Christianity is the only religion. That's if I can call it religion. It's not religion. You know it's not religion. But so that you know people understand it. It's the only religion where the God they serve guarantees them an inheritance. Guarantees them a possession. Guarantees that they will possess something. this life that changes life and changes nations. So they will not perish but have everlasting life, eternal life. To understand this, now let your ear go like I am here. To understand what I'm going to explain next, hear me now. Who is eternal? God. Who is everlasting? God. Right? Alright. So the Father says, Jesus, make sure you let them understand that if they believe on you, not only will they not perish, but I guarantee them that they will possess the life that God alone has. Who is eternal? God. Who is everlasting? God. So if God says, he guarantees us eternal life, then what's he saying? He's telling us that we will not perish, but we will have the life that makes God God. No.
Amen.
Oh my boy, I pray for revelation. Pray for the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowing in the knowing knowledge of God. Alright? Pray that prayer in Ephesians chapter 1. And then the one in chapter 3. Pray for yourself. That the eyes of your heart will be flooded with light so that you will know. Because that is the problem for most of you. You read about it, but you don't know. Because with God, to know is not intellectual accumulation of facts. With God, to know is to experience. You know God's love, and you have not experienced that love in your being. No, you only know it in your head. He's saying to us, the power of the gospel lies in this very fact. That God says, if anyone comes to Jesus Christ and believes on him, not only will he not perish, not only will he survive and overcome in the midst of this life on earth, that is dog eat dog. That's how I put it. Dog eat dog. See, that life on earth is dog eat dog. If your dog is a small dog and my dog is a big dog, mine will eat yours up. That is life on earth. It happens in the business world. Businesses are taken over by larger, bigger corporations. That's what it is in the life of earth. Dog eat dog. And woe be unto you if your dog is a small dog. Somebody's dog will come and eat yours up. That is the struggle of life. That is what makes men helpless in the face of circumstances that are too overwhelming. But listen to me, my brethren. God says, if you believe, if you don't repent, if you don't kick against me, if you submit your life to me, I guarantee that you overcome whatever Satan throws at you. But more than that, I will give to you the life that makes me God. The life that makes God God. Who is God? Eternal life is the life of God that he gives to man. Oh my goodness. Did you read 1 John? Whosoever is born of God. That's what. That's what. Overcomes. Over what? Overcomes what? The world. What is in the world? Affliction, pain, evil, demonic powers, helplessness, hopelessness.
Be lived out.
you know what it means to have no dime in your pocket and then to go to your daddy God and to pray and God brings it? Do you know what it means to commune with God so that you have the audience with heaven and you know that God is with you? Do you know that life? Do you know what it means to have God open his being to you so that you commune with him and you are filled with that which God pours into your being? I'm talking about Christianity. I'm not talking about churchianity. I'm not talking about denominationalism. I'm not talking about Pentecostalism. Are you hearing me? I'm talking about Jesus. Today is Thursday, tomorrow Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I've got only three more days to blow your soul up. Blow your soul. Blow your soul so that you get happy with your God. Listen, there's nothing like knowing that God is God in your being. Knowing. See, that drives away fear. That takes care of fear in this life. That takes care of worry. That takes care of lack. That takes care of weakness, of helplessness. Why? Because God lives on the inside. Greater is he who is in the church or who is in me. Eternal life. The last time I read Bible, he told me that it was this life. Go read the book of Hebrews and look at the priesthood of Jesus Christ. How he became priest. How Jesus is called priest. Because he had no priesthood on your earth. Because on earth it was for Aaron. The Bible says it was the power. He was made priest according to the power. The power of this imperishable life. That's what makes him priest. That's why you and I are priests. That's how we are made priests. Not because we went to some cemetery and got some degrees, our seminary and got some degrees. Listen, I went to cemetery, but they couldn't murder me. I love you. Brethren, I have just said a few things just to prick your attention. This John 3:16. From Genesis through Revelation, you find it in there. John 3:16. From Genesis to Revelation, cover the whole Bible. The power that brought Jesus here is the power of love. And what he gives to us is the power of his life. You see that? And you find out that the Bible says, and all you even listen to what the apostle says. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Why, Paul? Because he pays my bills. He pays my bills and, you know, he blesses me. No. It is the power of God unto salvation for everyone who believes, to the Jew first and then to the Gentile. You see that? For there in that gospel, hear me now, please. Ask us, please. In that gospel, says the Holy Ghost, is revealed only one characteristic. That man never knew. Man never knew. Since the fall of Adam, we have never known that characteristic that Jesus Christ alone brought down here. The Holy Spirit said through the Apostle Paul, because it is the power of God, because therein is revealed the righteousness of God. Not the prosperity, not the blessing, righteousness. Hear me now. The blessings of God, alright, come only in one way, in the path of righteousness. Somehow, if you are being blessed and you live a crooked life, check who is blessing you. Because the other guy too is blessing you. The crooked guy blesses. Are you hearing me? Jesus says, seek ye first one. My kingdom. Hold on. My kingdom. Seek my kingdom. What is that? What is the kingdom? The rulership, the dominion, the majesty, the power, the authority, the lordship of Jesus Christ. Because where God rules, there is his kingdom. So seek my rulership, seek my dominion, seek my power over your life. Seek my way of making people right. Call righteousness. Righteousness. That is what Jesus brought from heaven. The righteousness of God that we never knew. We had our own righteousness. Even the homeless man has his own righteousness. Even the crooked man has his own righteousness. The God is self-righteousness. The righteousness that men had before Jesus came here, the righteousness is self-righteousness. Self. It's the righteousness that comes from God is only received by faith. It is a gift. God gives it. He plants it in the soul of one who believes on Jesus Christ. This is the righteousness that produces holy living. You can't have righteousness without holiness. They go together. You can't have holiness without purity. You can't have purity without uprightness of heart, of walk. The power of the gospel is the power of a righteous life. Are you hearing me? Righteous life. I have said a few things, which you know. I haven't said a lot. I just wanted to say hi, hi, no rules. That's all in the Holy Ghost. Can I let me say something, then we all do it tomorrow, right? You want to learn that? You want to learn that? Come on, want to learn that? Yeah, I want to say something. This is something wonderful. One day I was murmuring and whining and complaining because all hell was breaking loose and I was tired of standing. So I went into a field to go and cry to God. I went to go and complain to God how he ain't helping me. Then the Lord just asked me, how are you? Just out of the blue, how are you, sir? How are you doing? I said, well, you know. Well, you know. I said, you know what? I said, well, you know. He said, you bless my family. No. Son, when I ask you, how are you? I want you to say this word. in the Holy Ghost. In the Holy Ghost. So what's the meaning? Say, son, it doesn't matter how you are feeling or how you don't feel. It doesn't matter what is going on in your life. My blessings are always in my spirit. And I have given my spirit to you. And you are in me. So when you declare, I am in the Holy Ghost, know what that means? You are affirming my blessing, my strength, my power. You are releasing it to work on your behalf. So I learned that. So when you ask me how you doing, I don't say I'm fine. And well, by God's grace, wonderful. How are you? In the Holy Ghost. Are you ready to practice that for tomorrow?
Yes.
How are you all doing? You see, that's how we greet each other. Okay, those who know me, everywhere I go, when they call me, the first one they want to greet me, in the Holy Ghost, I say, in the Holy Ghost. Oh, I love it, man. No, you know, there was a mighty man of God called John Fletcher. Fletcher of Madley. Fletcher in England here. These are the men that I walked with. You know, they are never gone, but I walk in what they left behind. Fletcher of Madley. You know, used to be a mighty man of prayer. When he met anybody, when he met you, He won't say, you know, this or that. He said, do I meet you praying? Ooh, I love that. Do I meet you praying? That's how he greeted people. Because he was so caught up in the Spirit of God that he wanted everybody to come out there with him. Do I meet you praying? Not whining, but praying. Hallelujah. Let's learn how to walk in the Spirit. You see, listen to me. I've said something to you. I've said something to you tonight. Okay? But I pray that in the name of Jesus, that you will rise in revelation. Amen. You will not perish. Because you have within you that imperishable life.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
For tonight, I thank you for the Spirit of God. I thank you for your love for your children. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you take away the veil that covers their eyes, the veil of darkness that covers their hearts, so that, Lord, they will begin to understand the power that lies resident in them, the power of that everlasting life, that indestructible life, in the name of Jesus Christ. I thank you for victory for every child of God that has listened to me tonight. I thank you, Lord, for a turnaround. I thank you for an opening in their understanding, an opening in their hearts, for the revelation of the Holy Ghost, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Bible. I don't want you to do the same thing I did. 1990 was the first time.
time I listened to him, and it turned my life around. I bought the whole pack. I bought the whole pack, and I gave some of them to some friends who didn't cherish the message. Now, years back, I remember last year, somebody called him and said, I'm looking for this message you preached in 1990. And he told the person, the best person that can get you the message is Ebenezer from the U.S. And the person called me and I said, I have that message. Hallelujah. How long is 1992 now? There were some messages that I gave to some pastors when they didn't cherish it. And I'm still, I wish I could have that message back. What I'm saying is, don't let this message go. We will put it on the CD. If I were you, I would get it. Because the more you listen to them, there was a message in prayer that actually spared my life. When I was in secondary school, the Lord used me mightily. In secondary school, I went to my secondary school where every year final student dies. But when I stepped into that school, I said, not when I'm here. Now, I listened to one of his messages, the manifestation of the gospel. Not just preaching, but demonstrating. And I took that demon that destroys our mates in that school. And that never happened again. Hallelujah. So we have tomorrow, we have Saturday. Saturday we might do two sessions. And Sunday, we are done. But it's not done. How many of you would like him to come back again? Hallelujah. Whether you like it or not, he will come back again. You see, he told you that if La Robert is here and the two of them come together, I'm just praying that doors will be open for us and that one day we'll do, maybe in a couple of years come, we'll do a whole week, do afternoon service teaching, and then the evening we'll do miracle healing rallies. And I'm not kidding, it's not by mind. I'll try to bring in another man from Ghana called Ajinasari, Bishop Ajinasari together, and then Mama Fernandez. Those of you who were here last year, Mama Fernandez, he's a prophetess. So the time will come, we'll have this all gift together because we have to have all the five-fold ministry in the house. And the whole week, we'll see how it goes. Hallelujah. But this is just to greet you. Tomorrow we're going, we're looking at the power of the gospel. Maybe this will help you to start paying attention when you are reading the Bible. He just preached on John 3:16. Hallelujah. Is it powerful enough? Now, I want us to do something. On your chairs, you will see white envelopes. Hallelujah. I want everybody to pick one. Pick one of the envelopes. Now, we have some few minutes to go. But before you put anything to that envelope, don't put anything to that envelope. Before you do that, I want Tim to share his testimony, what happened to him last year when we had a program. Tim, so do you want to come here and share with us what the Lord did for you last year when we had a program? Hallelujah. I don't want to, especially the young people who come to church and they haven't got anything to give. Decide from tonight that you're going to change your financial status from church point of view. Hallelujah. Don't think I'm young. I started giving tithe when I was in secondary school. When my parents give me money, I take 10% and put it up, and Sunday I go and give, put it in the oven. I don't eat everything because I'm not working.
Hallelujah. I said this is an impromptu call. Anyway, I'm wondering which of the testimonies. Anyway, last year, while we came for the conference, Mama Fernandez made a statement that, which, if you give something, believe God and plant a seed, sow a seed. And I was working, but I needed a new job. And I was praying. So last year, actually, when I was coming to the conference, I said, you know what, I've been working with these men of God, they come and they go and do things, but last year, something has to change for me. Personally, something has to change. I have to get something out of the conference. So I came, and so many things went on. But as she was preaching, and he said, and it came to the sowing thing. I said, okay, maybe that's one thing I have never done. Something like that. I do so, but go overboard. I mean, soaring overboard. That is something I have never done. So maybe I should give it a go. Try it and see. So I planted my seed. I planted half of it, and I left and went home. But when I got home, I thought about it and I said, I'm giving more. So when I came back and I gave more. After that, I went home and I said, God, I have planted a seed. God, I believe your servant, and I have planted a seed. Do something for me. God, this job I want, make it come through. Before that, I have been to the interview. The guy seemed not interested in employing me. So I went back and I prayed again, God, and I ran the person again. And he said, okay, come and see me. If it was Monday there or Wednesday. I went to the guy and God willing, he gave me the job. And now I'm working at that same place. The miracle thing I'll say is, where I was working, even the job that I had, I get paid is two times what I was earning at the previous work. So, the testimonies, okay, I'll end here, because last year's conference, there were so many testimonies, and so many things are still happening. But I'll end here. Amen.
He went to interview in January. You listen to the story. He went to interview in January. The people forgot about him. We finished the program 2nd September, which is a Sunday. And then on Tuesday, they called him to come for a second interview. They've already decided. When they mentioned that the amount they're going to pay him is twice what he was earning before, so he didn't even negotiate for more. Glory be to God. Not only him. What I'm saying is, there has to be a time in your life when you challenge yourself. You see, when my brother came, he told us something we call Benjamin offering. Benjamin, you see, Jacob said, my son Joseph is gone. The next one is Benjamin. I'm not going to release Benjamin. But they were starving. And Joseph, they didn't know, but Joseph was saying, unless you release Benjamin, I am not going to give you what you need. Are you catching it? He said, what you have in your hand and you are holding on to, you love it so much, you are afraid to release. If you don't release it, you won't get what you want. So he said, forget it. But they were still hungry and they were running out of food. And he kept on telling the children, go and buy more food. We have. He said, the man doesn't want our money. He said, unless we bring what? Benjamin. We don't have to see his face. But when he released Benjamin, everybody said, when he released Benjamin, he has been lied to that Joseph is dead. Was Joseph dead? Does he know Joseph is now a prime minister in Egypt? Did he know that Joseph is the wealthiest man in Egypt? Not even in Egypt, in the whole world. But until he released Benjamin, before he got the news that your Joseph, which you thought has died many years, is still alive. So he released Joseph and Benjamin, but he got what? Benjamin, and he got what? Joseph, with accumulated wealth from Egypt. Hallelujah. Are you listening to what I'm saying? Or Robert will tell you that if what you are holding on is not enough to meet your need, then that's not your breakthrough. Release that. Listen. It's God who supplies our needs, not our will.
Put your hands together. Put your hands together with Jesus. Hallelujah.
Blessed be your name. Yes, and that is plentiful. With the streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Thank you.
We thank you for Jesus, for your love for us. It is written, if God did not withhold his Son from us, but gave him up for us all, how will he not with him also freely give us all things? Father God, your will be done.
For any Mana Mission Church in your area and invite your friends to listen. Until then, remember that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. May God richly bless you, and he will, in Jesus' name. Amen.